Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned, in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done, and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask, Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Of charity and life, Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall stand at the head of your calendar. You shall reckon the first month of the year. Tell the whole community of Israel, on the 10th of this month, every one of your families must procure for itself a lamb, one apiece for each household. If a family is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join the nearest household in procuring one, and shall share in the lamb in proportion to the number of persons who partake of it. The lamb must be a year old male and without blemish. You may take it from either the sheep or the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of this month, and then, with the whole assembly of Israel present, it shall be slaughtered during the evening twilight. They shall take some of its blood and apply it to the two doorposts the lintel of every house in which they partake of the lamb. That same night they shall eat its roasted flesh with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. This is how you are to eat it: with your loins girt, sandals on your feet, and your staff in hand. You shall eat like those who are in flight. It is the Passover of the Lord. For on this same night I will go through Egypt, striking down every firstborn of the land, both man and beast, and executing judgment on all the gods of Egypt, I, the Lord. But the blood will mark the houses where you are. Seeing the blood, I will pass over you. Thus, when I strike the land of Egypt, no destructive blow will come upon you. This day shall be a memorial feast for you, which all your generations shall celebrate. Pilgrimage to the Lord as a perpetual institution." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our blessing cup is a communion with the blood of Christ.
Our blessing cup is a communion with the blood of Christ.
How shall I make a return to the Lord for all the good he has done for me? Cup of salvation I will take up, and I will call upon the name of the Lord.
Our blessing cup is a communion with the blood of Christ.
Precious in the eyes of the Lord is the death of his faithfulness. I am your servant, the son of your handmaid. You have loosed my bonds.
Our blessing cup is a communion with the blood of Christ.
To you will I offer sacrifice of thanksgiving, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. My vows to the Lord I will pay in the presence of all his people.
Our blessing cup is a communion with the blood of Christ.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was handed over, took bread, and, after he had given thanks, broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, also the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this
feast of Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to pass from this world to the Father. He loved his own in the world, and he loved them to the end. The devil had already induced Judas, son of Simon the Iscariot, to hand him over. So, during supper, fully aware that the Father had put everything into his power, and that he had come from God and was returning to God, he rose from supper and took off his outer garments. He took a towel and tied it around his waist. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and dry them with a towel around his waist. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Master, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered and said to him, "What I am doing, you do not understand now, but you will understand later." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered him, "Unless I wash you, you will have no inheritance with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Master, then not only my feet, but my hands and head as well." Jesus said to him, "Whoever has bathed has no need except to have his feet washed, for he is clean all over. So you are clean, but not all." For he knew who would betray him. For this reason, he said, "Not all of you are clean." So when he had washed their feet, he put his garments back on and reclined at table again. He said to them, "Do you realize what I have done for you? You call me teacher and master, and rightly so, for indeed I am. If I therefore, the master and teacher, have washed your feet, you ought to wash one another's feet. I have given you a model to follow, so that as I have done for you, you should also do." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Seeking Our Lady's intercession, let us pray. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. During this interesting time in our country, in our culture, especially in our church, it's really a good time for teaching. There are subtle points of theology that are very helpful, church doctrine, teachings of the saints, certainly even the Code of Canon Law at times, that can really help us during this separation from the sacraments, especially on this day of all days, in which we begin the Most Holy Triduum, in which we celebrate the Passover of the Lord, the Last Supper. It's interesting to note that as Catholics, our moral obligation, although for most of us it has been dispensed, by our bishops, is to attend Mass, not to receive communion. It's very interesting. To attend Mass, not to receive communion. Now there's a precept of the Church, right, a rule that we all must follow if we are to call ourselves Catholic, which is at least once a year to receive communion. It's recommended during the Easter season. Sadly, that might not be possible, but it's just a recommendation. The fact of the matter is, if you call yourself Catholic and aren't receiving communion at least once a year, well, the Eucharist, body, blood, soul, and divinity of our Lord Jesus Christ is the source and the summit of our faith. If you're not even doing that, then how can you be Catholic? But that's not the moral obligation placed upon us. The moral obligation is to attend Mass each Sunday and Holy Day of obligation. Obviously, we can't do that at this time. Why is that the obligation? And not receiving Holy Communion? Isn't the whole point of Mass receiving Holy Communion? Isn't that why Jesus celebrated it and empowered the first bishops, the first pope, in order to do the same? Right? This Last Supper liturgy is an ordination Mass. That's what Jesus is actually doing. It's the first consecration and the first ordinations. He's doing this because he wants his people to have his body and his blood. But that's the gift he is making to you. Right? That's the gift he is making to you. And that's the greatest gift. And it is and should be an agony that we can't receive him as often in his sacramental form. But the reason our moral obligation is placed not in receiving communion is because, well, maybe I'm in grave sin and I can't receive. But I can still go to Mass. And what can I do at Mass? And why is that an obligation? It's because I have this responsibility to worship God. I have a moral obligation to worship him. That is given in the Old Testament laws, right, in the Ten Commandments. I am the Lord thy God, thou shalt have no other gods before me. Keep holy the Sabbath day, that's my day, the day in which you rest and you worship me. So this moral obligation is why we have to go to Mass. Because even if I can't receive Holy Communion, I must worship. I must worship. Now the Jews, they understood this because the Lord had taught them to worship God. Centuries and centuries of working with him, giving them the law and the prophets. They had the rituals down, right? They had all of the rituals. God gave them the rituals. We know that there were many Sadducees and Pharisees, right, who celebrated the rituals. They celebrated them publicly, and they celebrated them faithfully, and they seemed to do it well. But the Lord said they were whitewashed tombs filled with dead men's bones. There was no love for God or for neighbor in them. And why is that? Because the external rituals aren't enough. And that's why this time is really special for us. Because you are being deprived of the external, not rituals, but sacraments. Real channels of grace, unlike the rituals of the Old Testament. They weren't real channels of grace. They were just rituals, preparing them for the gift of the sacraments of Christ. So you're deprived, yes, of these sacraments, these external signs given to us by Jesus for the imparting of grace. But that doesn't mean you can't worship God in your hearts and in your homes. It's the reason we call the family the domestic church. Like, if you can't come to Mass, if you're not allowed, if you can't come to the church to worship God, you can do it at home. Because for the Lord, the most important thing, of course, is that you worship him in your heart. Now, don't think that Father Miller is, you know, preaching Protestant theology and everybody's going to be up in our, you know, worried and everything. Again, consider the church teachings. If one is ill and at home and can't get to Mass, there's no sin. Why? Because they can still worship him, even sick in their bed. If one is imprisoned and isn't allowed to leave and attend Mass, or a priest isn't able to go there and celebrate Mass with them, there's no sin as long as they worship God in their heart and do some type of ritual that they can do. Could be praying a rosary, reading the scriptures, there's any number of things, doing a novena. Even in a case in which you're caring for a sick person, a relative, again, there's no sin in missing Mass. Obviously, attending the sacraments, being physically present there to worship in that manner is the highest form. That's why it was given to us by Jesus. But don't think he's going to deprive any grace. He's going to hold anything back from you as long as you are doing your best
to worship him in your heart and in your home. So the last little point to teach you about this very first Mass given to us by Jesus himself. No lay people were present, and no lay people received Holy Communion at this Mass. It was our Lord and the Apostles. Even the Blessed Mother wasn't there. It's interesting. On some level, you can imagine how this must be. Stuck in your homes, unable to be here with this very small congregation we have this evening. Our Lady must have known what our Lord was doing. They would probably have discussed this, I expect, beforehand. And yet she wasn't there. In fact, Our Lady would have never received communion from her son. She would only receive communion from the apostles. Regardless, I think it's an opportunity for us to enter more deeply into these mysteries. We give thanks to God. We praise him in our hearts. We lift up our voices, even in our homes. We worship him wherever we may be. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
rather that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands, for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all his holy church.
Grant us, O Lord, we pray, that we may participate worthily in these mysteries. For whenever the memorial of this sacrifice is celebrated, the work of our redemption is accomplished through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord, for he is the true and the eternal priest, who instituted the pattern of an everlasting sacrifice, and was the first to offer himself as the saving victim, commanding us to make this offering as his memorial. As we eat his flesh, that was sacrificed for us, we are made strong. And as we drink his blood that was poured out for us, we are washed clean. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we proclaim.
Sanctus, Sanctus, Sanctus Dominus Deus Sabaoth, pleni sunt caeli et terra, gloria tua. Hosanna in excelsis, benedictus, qui venit in nomine Domini. Hosanna in excelsis.
You therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Peter, our Bishop, and all those who, holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants, and all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, for they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls, and hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true, celebrating the most sacred day on which our Lord Jesus Christ was handed over for our sake, and in communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious Ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and Joseph, her spouse, her blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysalius, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers in all things, we may be defended by your protecting help. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family, which we make to you as we observe the day on which our Lord Jesus Christ handed on the mysteries of his body and blood for his disciples to celebrate. Order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation, and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect, make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, for our salvation and the salvation of all that is today, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands. And with eyes raised to heaven, he, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. Sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us, who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son, may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing, through Christ our Lord. Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. To us also, your servants, who though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon, through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them. Fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen.
Praecetis salutaribus momenti et divina institutione formati. Audemus dicere,
Pater noster, qui es in celis, sanctificetur nomen tuum, adveniat regnum tuum, fiat voluntas tua, sicut in cielo et in terra. Panem nostrum quotidianum da nobis hodie, et dimitte nobis debita nostra, sicut et nos dimittimus debitoribus nostris, et ne nos inducas in tentationem, sed libera nos a malo.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant your peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit. that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
This is the body that will be given up for you. This is the chalice of the new covenant in my blood, says the Lord. Do this whenever you receive it in memory of me. Brothers and sisters at home who could not attend the Holy Mass, I would encourage you at this time to make your spiritual communion. Again, imagine yourself, close your eyes at your own church, if possible, proceeding up and kneeling down at the communion rail. Imagine either myself or your pastor before you, holding up the consecrated species and proclaiming the body of Christ. Say to the Lord in your mind and heart, amen. Ask the Lord to banquet for all eternity, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Divine praises. Blessed be God. Blessed be his holy name. Blessed be Jesus Christ, true God and true man. Blessed be the name of Jesus. Blessed be his most sacred heart. Blessed be his most precious blood. Blessed be Jesus, the most holy sacrament of the altar. Blessed be the Holy Spirit, the Paraclete. Blessed be the great Mother of God, Mary most holy. Blessed be her holy and immaculate conception. Blessed be her glorious Assumption. Blessed be the name of Mary, Virgin and